Welcome to Loma Linda Filipino Church at Worship. It is good to come to the Lord and worship Him. So even though we are not physically together, I praise the Lord that we can still worship Him. Our call to worship this morning is found in Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name, for the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. May God bless the reading of this word. Will be
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Happy Sabbath to all of you. Before we are going to meet the Lord in His garden of prayer, I would like to share with you a passage from the scriptures that is found in the book of Proverbs, chapter 4, verses 20 to 22. And I shall be reading from the Revised Standard Version as well as from the Living Bible. So, chapter 4, verse 20, Revised Standard. My son, be attentive to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Let them not escape from your sight. Keep them within your heart, for they are life to him who finds them and healing to all his flesh. From the Living Bible, Listen, my son of mine, to whom I say, listen carefully. Keep these thoughts ever in mind. Let them penetrate deep within your heart, for they will mean real life for you and radiant health. Let us now seek the Lord through prayer. Shall we bow our heads down together? Okay, let us pray. Dear God, we humbly come before your throne of grace this morning, just as we are and where we are in our respective homes. Indeed, we praise and worship you in this special holiday, despite our ongoing situation. Nothing will separate us from you, and it is our determination to remain and abide with you in times of peace, in times of rejoicing, and in times of difficulties. Above all, we would like to praise you for being faithful and true to your promises, that you will always be with us, even until the end of the world. Father, while many people around us and everywhere are worried, we are firm and unmoved by the troubles of this world. We are your salt and light of the world, and we believe that because of us, the whole world is blessed because of our presence, because of your presence in us. We have that peace that passes all understanding, that the world do not understand why in the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of tribulation, we are of good cheer, because our Lord Jesus has warned us in the book of John, chapter 16, verse 33, and we take him at his word. Father, as we worship you today, please allow your Holy Spirit to dwell again in our hearts, even as we listen to your message, and as we fellowship with one another through this virtual Zoom gathering in your name. We are grateful that we have a God like you, full of grace and blessings that you have abundantly prepared for us to receive this day. We do not forget to pray for our brothers and sisters who are physically sick. We bring them to you, Lord. We have brothers and sisters who are suffering, even in China, in other parts of the world. We commit them to you, Lord. We have members who are isolated and lonely. Please cheer them up, Lord, and help us always to rejoice in your salvation. Help us all to look forward to the soon coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for all your provisions to us and for answering our prayers, because we ask all these favors in Jesus' name. Amen.
Serving more than 9,500 students combined, Andrews, Loma Linda, and Oakwood Universities are specially tasked with preparing future church leaders for the mission fields of healthcare and pastoral work. You can tangibly help us, Vanessa, who chose to attend Loma Linda University because of its holistic approach to health. To her, health went beyond physical healing. It included the social, emotional, intellectual, environmental, and spiritual health of her patients. Or you could help a student like Christian, who was raised Roman Catholic in Ecuador and decided to leave a career in technology to become a pastor and attend a seminary at Andrews University. His friends, family, sponsors, and mentors at Andrews help him rekindle the spark that ignites a commitment toward a true revolution of thought and action, and wants to wholeheartedly change this world with Christ and for Christ. Please give generously to make a difference for students like Vanessa and Christian. Your help will be greatly multiplied by all those who are assisted by these future leaders of our churches.
Sabbath, everyone. We continue part three of this series called Dynamics of Salvation. 2 weeks ago, Pastor Lambert started off this series, and Pastor Manalo, our senior pastor, continued with part two in terms of how faith takes us to our true selves. And today I will continue about how faith helps us aware of our behavior and our relationship with others. And so this morning we're going to take a look into a journey that may be a little uncomfortable for some of us. And most of the time when we come to church pre-COVID or now on these online worship experiences, we come here for the preaching of God's word. We hope to be encouraged and receive strength. And while that is the goal of our series, We also want to be able to help each one of us in that path of discipleship. That's another component of preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. The central theme of the scripture is God's love for his creation and his way of salvation by faith apart from works through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But the question is, what did Jesus come to save us from? Many people would say that he came to save us from our sins. And while that is true, Jesus Christ came indeed to save us from the penalty of sin and its influences in our lives. The consequences of sin is experiencing what the Bible calls the wrath of God. And when you hear that word, the wrath of God, what is your immediate reaction to that? Now, be honest. I'll be honest with you. You know, when I think of the wrath of God, it kind of scares me. It kind of terrifies me. It stirs up painful memories of my mom saying anytime I misbehave as a kid, wait till your dad gets home. And how much of that childhood experience fills me with dread when I hear about God's wrath. It's probably the reason that we love to emphasize the God of the Old Testament, right? Rather than the God of the Old Testament. We're more comfortable with the God of love and grace of the New Testament than the many examples where God was wrathful and acted wrathful to the people of Israel. But the point that I want to say as we move into this message is that we need to get serious about sin and the way that sin is revealed in our lives. And so I want you to buckle up and have your Bibles open in Romans 1, verses 18 and 32. And before we continue with that, let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father God, I pray for your Spirit to be with us. We thank you of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God for salvation to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it, this righteousness of God is revealed. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. Amen. The wrath of God is started out in verse 18, and it starts this way. This wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness, since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. And you could read down those verses and come to 28, where the list of our sins are revealed. Furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, verse 28, so God gave them over to a depraved mind so that they ought not to do what ought not to be done. And they have become filled with every kind of weakness. And here starts the list: evil, greed, and depravity. They're full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They have no understanding, no fidelity, no love, no mercy. And although they know God's righteousness decree, who do such things deserve death, listen to this, they not only to continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. So today we will start by asking and answering this question: why is God wrathful? Within these opening verses, we see two words that are triggers for God's wrath. What are they? Godlessness and wickedness. Godlessness and wickedness. So let's define them. Godliness is something that does not reflect God's character, does not reflect his image or purpose. My father-in-law was a carpenter, and while I tried to impress him the time I was dating his daughter, who later on became my wife, I didn't have a very good start because I'm all thumbs when it comes to working around tools. I remember when I helped at the Bayanihan in putting things on the roof, can't even remember what they're called, and to nail them down, it would take me several hits of a hammer on that nail, or my father would take it like in two or three hits. And despite that, you know, he gave his blessing to marry his daughter. And I remember working on a project where I was up on a ladder, and I'm hitting, you know, I have this nail that I need to pound something in. And I didn't want to step down from the ladder. And so rather to get the hammer, I used instead a screwdriver and took the end of the screwdriver and was pounding the nail into the wall. And when he came in and he saw that, he was really, you know, upset that I would incorrectly use a tool that was not designed for that task. And so that's kind of how I see godliness. Our Father designed the universe to function in the way he created it, according to his design and will. And anything that goes against that is less than God's design or godlessness. So most people practice godlessness through apathy or not being concerned about how everything that you do is an evidence to whom you truly follow. God or the evil one? Are you following God or the evil one? Now, you could accidentally be godless through carelessness or lack of thinking about your thought or your action. An example of this would be the puzzling idea of how some call themselves Christian and routinely use Jesus' name as a curse word. While godliness is at times what somebody describes spiritual laziness, if left unchecked, however, it will proceed to the next thing that brings about God's wrath. Wickedness, on the other hand, is a purposeful choosing of evil over good. It's not just a lazy mindset, but a decision to do that which God calls evil. It is a conscious choice to prefer darkness over light. And that's how John, the disciple, describes wickedness perfectly. In John 3:19, Jesus is speaking to Nicodemus about why he has come into the world. And after that, incredible verses describing God's love for the world through offering up of his son for our sins, Jesus then summarizes the human condition. And that human condition is that some prefer wickedness over God. And so comes the verdict that light has gone into the world, but people loved darkness rather than light. Why? Because their deeds were evil. Verse 20, everyone who does evil hates the light. And that's what wickedness is, choosing the evil one's path over God's gift of salvation. And that's why the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against these two conditions. It is humanity sort of standing in front of God saying, I know better than you, God. So you get out of the way and let me do what I want to do. Now, it's bad enough when people choose to be godless and wicked. But there's a third thing about what brings about the wrath of God. Not only does a person choose to be spiritually lazy, not only do some choose to openly rebel against God and his ways, and they block others from coming to the truth, it's one thing that you want to not be saved and to be lost, but the third thing that brings about God's wrath is when you actively block others from knowing that there is a way out, that there's good news. You block them from hearing the good news. So let's stop and consider something. Kind of, does this explain what we see in the evening newscast or cable news or in social media? Does this explain what we see in our society today? That there seems to be a conspiracy. The conspiracy of the evil one of darkness who wants to win, who wants to encourage God's church to follow in its evil ways and to deny the good news of salvation by grace through faith. And so what do we do? How can God hold humanity guilty if there's so many things that society denies the truth from our eyes? It's kind of what Paul addresses next. Remember, the entire book of Romans is written like a legal argument. It's like Paul standing in front of the entire world, giving a closing argument in defense of the good news. He's a good lawyer, and he answers and the questions that are forming in his audience's mind even before they can think of asking them. One of the most common questions posed in Christianity is, how can God hold people guilty if the entire world system is denying the truth? A revelation of God, verses 19 and 20, now Paul starts with this whole concept of natural revelation. And all you got to do is Google, evolution and creation, La Sierra University. In the last couple of years, the Adventist Church has even been struggling whether or not evolution should be taught at our Adventist University. And I don't know what your thoughts are about that, but you could research and you could see that our own church is struggling how to navigate this space of training our students in science and nursing and medical doctor with the concepts of evolution, and would doing so be a denial of our faith? How do we navigate those conflicting spaces? For me, my position is that the study of biology, anatomy, physiology, and all the intricacies of ordered creation gives support for a supreme intelligence of a creation, of an intelligence. There is no possible way that all this happened with a big bang or by chance that took evolutionary course through billions of years. Dr. John Lennox of Oxford is one of the most renowned and famous mathematicians in the world. And he calculated the probability of life spontaneously developing out of random chance. And I like how he put it in terms of the odds of winning a lottery. And he said that the odds of the world as it is, by evolution, is 303 billion to one. God has given us creation as evidence of his existence. And that's why the Bible says that creation points to creator. So humanity cannot be without excuse. But we also have special revelation. And the Bible and the Holy Spirit both show us that way of salvation. Ultimately, we're faced with a choice, because some people prefer darkness over the light, that they refuse to come to the light. They are willfully ignorant of the truth. And when as an individual or as a collective church or society prefer darkness over the light, then we begin that downward slide into the remaining judgment that Paul brings out in these verses. Verse 21 and 21 talks about that. You could read it. Verses 21 and 23, it says, "For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. For in their thinking they became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. And although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images that are made to mortal man and birds and animals, etc., and reptiles." So in our society, in this Western world, this began with Charles Darwin's Origin of Species in the late 1800s. Schools allowed this, swallowed this up and began teaching evolution to the students, and dozens of generations are affected, having rejected Genesis chapter 1. And so another issue that was covered in these verses is sexual promiscuity. And you could read that in Romans 1 verses 24 and 25. And I could just address it with these few verses. "Therefore, God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another." I've heard about a Adventist intern just recently come out and identified himself as a gay person, although he says, "I do not act on my gay identification and I choose to remain celibate." As a result of that, his sponsoring conference has let him go, pretty much has fired him, and then now he's putting his case in social media. And if you're interested, you know, send me a comment, your email, and I will give you, or you could Google it yourself, and you could find that our Adventist church, the generation coming behind us, are going to be facing what to do with the issue of the LGBTQ in our church moving forward. But it's interesting how Apostle Paul addresses this concept of homosexuality. But I don't want to focus just on that, because many of us have other issues and other sins that we could be called out on. For example, you know, the Bible talks about the sins of gossip, lying. For some, it could be anger or rage. For others, it is stealing. Everyone has a struggle to face in life. And rather of pointing one sin over another sin, what I would like to encourage is that we see ourselves desperately needing the healing and transformative power of Jesus in our lives. And so I know that as we move forward in our church, that there's going to be issues of this. And we need God's guidance and wisdom as we move forward. One of the things that I find interesting in the Bible is the story of the Amorites. They were probably in stage two when God had told Abraham in Genesis 15 that their sin was not complete, but it was coming to a judgment, and that Israel was going to be used to bring about judgment against the nation of the Amorites. God ordered Joshua and every single person to kill, no matter how young or old, was to be killed. But before that time of total destruction, God sent a final warning in the form of a judgment. Verse 24, 26, and 28 of Romans all have that same language, that God gave them over. So I close this talk about the final judgment that is coming. And what happens is that I believe that comes when God removes his restraining presence. I personally don't know the reasons God does things, but he does it like a parent whose small child won't stay next to him, say, in a big store. And so they may choose to hide themselves to cause the child to panic, to search him out, you know, and to find where mom and dad is so that they could be close to him. That biblical example is found in Ezekiel 10. When the Spirit of God leaves the temple in stages or in steps, first to the threshold to get the attention of the religious leaders who are so blinded by their own pride and they're not even aware of it. And so then God's Spirit chooses to leave the temple. And I believe that that's kind of where we are today. For the past several years, I mean, we've all been praying that God blesses our church, that God blesses this country of America that we love, that most of us have immigrated here to be part of its constitution and its lifestyle and its dreams and its responsibility. But we need to reflect and ask ourselves, did we squander the incredible gifts that God has given us? Could it be that God is removing his presence from our nation? And the Bible describes this thing in Romans as that God's wrath and judgment may be imminent. I'm sure hoping we're not there yet. Some have wondered whether this COVID-19 is a judgment of God. I'm not going to make a statement about that. You can make your own conclusion. But I want to close with Joshua, Jeremiah. God's working in the prophet Jeremiah. And in Jeremiah 11, I had to wrestle with myself to even share this with you. And I'm not sure whether it's prophetic or not, but God is letting me know and letting us know as a church what is coming. The Old Testament prophet Jeremiah is dealing with a nation that rejected everything that he prophesies and refused to turn and repent of their wicked ways. So God gives Jeremiah a prophetic word about the future of Israel and Judah, saying that they had left the covenant relationship that we were to have with God. Jeremiah 11:11 says this. Therefore, this is what the Lord says, that I will bring onto them a disaster that they cannot escape. And although they cry out to me, I will not listen to them. Verse 14, do not pray for this people, nor offer any plea or petition for them, because I will not listen when they call to me in the name of their distress. It's my hope and my prayer as I close out this message that we're not there yet, that what's happening now with this global pandemic will grab our attention and let us know that while there are all kinds of bad news going on around us in the way that we relate to one another, that God is still giving us space to navigate with the good news. And if you return and follow in this series moving forward, the bad news precedes the good news, but the good news is great and awesome news. That God so loves his people back in Roman times, but he loves it throughout Christendom and also to us in this 21st century. That if we just focus and look to him in faith, apart from works of law, that he is going to change our lives, give us hope and encouragement, and prepare us as a people to live with him throughout eternity. May these words, though it may be hard and harsh to hear, prepare us to receive the good news that God has justified us by faith and not by words. And this is my hope and prayer for you on this Sabbath day as you face another week. God bless you. See you back next week. You have many options, but I'm glad that you are a part of this series called Discipleship, this Dynamics of Salvation, and you will stay tuned and come back next week. God bless you. Happy Sabbath.
My best, I can maybe impress you with tender words and harmony, clever rhyme or two. But if all I've done in the times we shared is turn your eyes on me, then I fail in what I've been called to do. Someone else I want you to see. Will you love Jesus more when we go on our separate ways? When this moment is a memory, Jesus more. I'd like to keep these memories, friends of gold and silver, and reminisce some years from now about the smiles we shared. But above all else, I hope you had come to know the Father's love. When you see our Lord face to face, you will hear Him say, "Well done, my son." Will you love Jesus more? For you to love Jesus.
I'd like to remind you also that you can still continue to give your tithes and offerings through our website. And we have different departments, including the children's department, Sabbath school department, and collegiate. I invite you to join in through Zoom each Sabbath. And I also like to let you know that those of you who are on the list for prayer, we are praying for you, and we would like for you to continue sending your requests via our website. Again, happy Sabbath, and may God bless each one of us.